At attention.
All right, just one quick thing. We've had a great time.
It will definitely be a barn burner, and I checked with Danny, and our insurance covers this. So come. Plus, I'll give a little preview of Thursday night, so you don't want to miss God of Wonders. I mean, we'll go into outer space. We'll go into the cells in the human body. We'll look at birds, fish. It's going to be so awesome. The main thing, we'll look at us as human beings and how God made us special in His image. Amen. It's going to be so much fun. And I think Veronica said it's popcorn night. We're having popcorn. So it's movie night, Thursday night. So, Bob, if you haven't had Jana on a date in a while, it's going to be a cheap one. Because we got the popcorn. Anyway, here we are at the end of this five-part series. And like I said last week, this has been fundamental stuff, but it's been fun. And it's been life-changing, hasn't it? So one of the things about on the ride on part I wanted to mention is once we got past the, for those of you who haven't been here, part one was called Get Up, and we talked about when you've been thrown to the ground or you're in the pit, how to get up through Holy Spirit power, just briefly. Sometimes we know what got us there, situations, circumstances, things out of our control, things in our control, like dependencies. Sometimes we don't know how we got there. Like a depression, or we just drifted away from the body of Christ, or something like that. But the answer is the same for both issues. Say, God, pull me up, pull me up, pull me up. And you get up. And then week two, we talked about mounting up. And you have to mount. When you mount up, you want to be ready to get on, because you want to mount up and stay up. Amen? So we talked about perseverance and all those things, because really the mount up is from the time you get saved. That's this dot right here, guys. Point in time conversion until you see Jesus Christ. We're riding like Pony Express riders. See there? Carrying what? The good news of Jesus Christ. The gospel of Jesus. Say the gospel of Jesus Christ. See how it just rolls off the tongue. This is good stuff. So that's what we did in week one and two. Then we talked about from this actual passage is where the final 3 weeks, including this, faith, hope, and love. And faith, faith is so awesome, but faith lives in the present. And let me explain that. It's the present, okay? We see by faith, we walk by faith, we hear by faith, we live by faith, we're justified by faith, we're saved through faith. It's all present. It's the now. It's the now. And in that week, it was like mustering up. It's like we're all getting ready to go somewhere. We finally mounted up. We've got all of our provisions. We're all together, right? We're all, just picture all of us stretched out on horses, just ready to ride, just like crazy. And we're full of anticipation, excitement. We've got our purpose. We've got our vision. We've got hope. We're carrying the gospel. It's just awesome. And in week two, we talked about the hope. And I kind of used three stages to explain this. I remember the Wizard of Oz. Was anybody not here last week? Raise your hand if you've seen the Wizard of Oz. Okay, you guys. I'll talk to you guys. After they found out their purpose, the mission was set before them. They were filled with anticipation, excitement, and they're ready to go, right? It's like, follow the yellow brick road, follow the yellow brick, you know what I'm saying? Then it's, we're off, and they all start dancing, and they go, and they're filled with faith. And that's stage one. That's faith, riding on with faith. But guess what? Where'd they end up? They end up in the woods. And this is where our hope is very vulnerable. Because hope, faith lives in the present. Hope lives in the future. We hold hope for what will come, not what we already have. So faith is what we have. Hope is what we're hoping for. So we're riding through the woods, right? And it's scary, and we're in enemy territory, and it's dark, and it's controlled by evil entities. And I'm talking about life, not the Wizard of Oz. And, you know, remember the flying monkey thing? I had a note from a gal that watches us online from Topeka, Kansas. Kathy, I love you. Shout out to her. She said that she watched last week's sermon, and she said, only I could pull off the flying monkey scene from The Wizard of Oz in a message about Christ. She also said she's terrified of the monkeys like I was when I was a kid, except she's gained so much weight in her older years. Sorry, Kathy, you said that. That the monkeys can't pick her up and fly off anymore. It's like, what are you going to do, take a ride? Here we are. I know that broke our concentration. We're in the dark woods. It's scary. Lions and tigers and bears. Oh, you guys are on tonight. That's where the devil's trying to dismount us. And as soon as we start losing any kind of hope, faith is gone, because faith lives in the present. We lose our vision of the future. Without a vision, the people perish. And so our hope gets dashed against the rocks, and faith's right behind it. And so we're riding through the woods, and we learned about how do we make it through the woods, and it was the main thing is the main thing, and that's where I'm going to go. Keep our eyes on Jesus Christ and our hope of glory, the glorious appearing of Jesus Christ. There will be a time where all the tears are wiped away, all the pain, all the suffering. There'll be no more of any of that stuff, for the old order is gone, as we read in Revelation chapter 21, verse 1, 2, 3, and 4, especially 4. All those things are gone. And then 5 says, the old order of things have passed away. Behold, all things are new. Amen? We also, when Dorothy and everybody, I'm back to the Wizard of Oz, when they came out of the woods, remember how dark it was behind them? But they were looking at a sun-drenched poppy field, and the sky was blue, and birds were singing, and they could see the city. The city. And remember what they sang? We're out of the woods, we're out of the dark, we're out of the night. Step into the sun, step into the light. And that's what we need to do. We don't live in the dark. We're children of the day. We're children of the day, and we need to act like it. We need to act like it. So we talked last week about getting through the woods section of the whole deal. So now we're talking about riding on with love. And the first thing I want to do here is I want to define it, okay? So let's just define what it is. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. I was messing around this week with this verse and thought, I'm going to replace love with God. Listen to how it sounds. God is patient. God is kind. He does not envy. He does not boast. He is not proud. He does not dishonor others. He's not self-seeking. He is not easily angered. He keeps no record of wrongs. God does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. He always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Now, why would I even... Yeah. Now, somebody's going, why would you do that? Well, that's our very first stop. God is love. So the very essence of God, the very character, the very nature of God is love. So we need to get that. So we're going to go right to 1 John 4, 6. It says, so we have come to know and to believe the love that God has for us. Stop there if you can. That's an action step. Know and believe. Know is your intellect. Believe is your heart. We've come to know and believe the love that God has for us. But this is the bombshell. God is love. He is defined as love. This is inspired by the Holy Spirit. God is love. It's His essence, it's His character, and His nature. He's love. He's love, guys. I can't help it. And let's just stay there for a minute before we go on, because this is a truth you got to know. You got to know, especially if you're living anywhere other than an abundance of God's love, or an abundance of God's joy, or an abundance of God's peace. You got to know this. God is love. Now, let me tell you, He can't love you any more or any less. Please, listen, if you don't hear anything else tonight, it's unconditional. It's called agape love, unconditional love. He can't love you any more or any less. Think of back in chapter, or in part one. You're on the ground, you're in the pit, you don't even want to get out. You're done. God must not think much of me now. Isn't that what you think? He's so distant, he doesn't even care. I've failed him. I've let him down. I've messed everything up. No, he can't love you any less. Let's let the pendulum swing to the other end. What if you're on top of the mountain? I mean, you are like, woohoo! I'm filled with the Holy Spirit. I'm bearing fruit. I'm witnessing to everybody I see. And I'm even leading people to Christ. Does God love you any more? No. He can't love you any more or any less. He loves you with an everlasting agape love. He is love, and he loves you, and he can't love you any more or any less. Everybody got that? He loves you. Like the song we sang, he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. How he loves us. So, he loves us. This is important because this is where we go from hang down hound dog look to standing on the mountain and say, praise God. I know I'm in the valley. I'm in the woods. This isn't temporary in the sense of it's going to go away next week. No, it's temporary in the sense that I'm going to see God face to face, and I'm going to have eternal life, and I'm going to live forever, and all this will be gone with the old world. Anybody got to praise him for that? I mean, look at the person to the side of you and say, praise him for that. Oh, yeah. I mean to tell you, he loves us so much. He had this plan from the beginning, but we're going to get there. Where'd I leave off? This was so awesome. Okay, he loves us. But let's read on. And whoever abides in love abides in God, and God abides in him. What do we do with the kind of love that I'm talking about? I mean, it's hard to even grasp because we don't have unconditional love for each other. I mean, really, we say we do. We don't. We don't. I mean, somebody does you wrong, you're done with them, you know. You know, I mean, you change insurance agents, you know, for no reason. I can save $200 over here. You know, whatever it is. It's conditional, okay? Because we live in the flesh. We live with a finite way of thinking. But he doesn't. So how do we, what do we do with this kind of love? And this is what we do. So listen up. We try to get a grasp on it first off, and then we reflect it back to him. We reflect that love back to him. So it's a two-way street. We reflect it back to him. And we do it in three ways. Worship, prayer, and service. And those are the three ways we reflect. So worship is the gift to him. We just did it. And if you did it right, you were offering him a gift, right? It's the gift to God. Lord, we're giving you this, and we hope it's a sweet, fragrant offering because we know you're a righteous and holy God and you're worthy. Sorry, I can't stay on tune. Sorry, I hit the wrong note, Calvin and God, on that last song. You gave me the look. But you know what I mean. We send it up as a gift. So that's the first way we can reflect it back to him is in our worship. The second is in our prayer. So this is the first is the gift. Communication. The second's the communication of prayer. He wants us to communicate with him. He wants us to be up close and personal. He wants us to be in constant contact. And I don't mean the email program that sends junk mail. He wants us in constant contact with him. That's why the scriptures say pray without ceasing. So we got worship, we got prayer. What was the third one? Service. Service. So that means, hey, just don't read his word. Do what it says. Do what it says. So if you read that we're supposed to reach out and help orphans, go do it. Horsepower is a half mile up the road. Or if you are supposed to give water to someone who's thirsty, all those things. It could be service within the church, too, just to help. This is fertile ground here. This is the number one fishing hole, remember? I talked about a few months ago. So our service actually is a reflection of the love back to God. So it's worship, prayer, service is our reflection of God's love from us back to him. Anything short of that is not a really good offering. And when you talk about abiding, Can we talk about abiding? How about, let's talk. I want to talk about abiding because abiding is a great word. You know, abiding really, the definition is live, stay, remain, dwell, make it your home, make it your casa. Has anybody here ever been on a vacation in the last 10 years? I know since 2008 it's been rough, right? Brent and I were on one before 2008. It was before Open Range, actually. And everybody's been on a vacation. I don't mean you're doing the antique malls in Greenwood. I'm talking about you're somewhere. Dave, that's not a vacation. Ruth Ann's tired of it. No. I'm talking where you go somewhere and you're seeing something you don't see every day, like the mountains or the beach. You know, I don't have to go into it. You know what I'm saying. And you're on vacation. And you're sitting there and you're looking at the mountains or you're looking at the beach and you're going, I could live here. Yeah, I mean, we've all done that. I could live here. He does live there. Okay, we got to talk. But I mean, when you're somewhere that isn't your home, that's what I'm talking about, and you're going, I could live here. And then all of a sudden, reality sets in. You're going, oh, I got a house and a mortgage, all my kids, grandkids. You know, I've got responsibilities, and I've got to go to work next Monday, and it really bums your whole vacation out. So don't do that. But the thing is, it's a vacation. It's not living there. So when Jesus wants us to abide, he's talking about living there. It's not a vacation. It's a staycation. I mean, it's like go there and stay there. Amen? So abide, abide, abide. So he says, whoever abides in love abides in me. So there's also an action step there, isn't it? We have to abide. And then he'll abide in us. We see this principle through Scripture. You know, draw unto me and I will draw unto you. I mean, it's part of it. He wants us in the context of free will to be making those first steps. That way he's not forcing us, right? He wants us to love him because we love him. Not because it's an obligation, not because we're programmed for it. So he says, whoever abides in love abides in God, and God abides in him. So yeah, it's a win-win, right? It's a win-win. So of what we've talked about already, we're going to break it down to just a couple of things. We know that he loves us, but guess what? We are loved. We are loved. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. There's that action step again. He died for the entire world. Just read it. The best person you'll ever meet and the worst person you ever meet, his sins were paid for by Jesus, but he has to believe. He has to step forward. He has to repent. He has to accept. He has to receive. Amen? It's an action. He wants us to make the first step in the context of free will, and we're not programmed. He wants us to do it because we want to do it. We want to do it. So I love this verse. I do. You know, I've been in business all of my life. My first business I had before I even had a driver's license. And back then it didn't matter, did it? Slaughter Boys Hay. That's why my back's bad to this day. But I was a businessman all my life, and you can't help when you live on this side of eternity to have some of those traits in your way of thinking. So if I was to look at this verse, and I'm a non-believer, okay, I'm going to be thinking risk and reward, because I see everything in the context of that. I see everything in the lens of risk and reward. Is there anybody that's going to admit that? I mean, you can't even, you know, put your money in the bank without wondering, you know, if you're ever going to get it back or whatever. Risk and reward. You do something for somebody, you're really hoping to get something back. I mean, you know what I'm saying? And Jesus actually says, if you do it not hoping to get anything back, because that's what counts. But we really hope to get something back. So risk and reward. So you're a non-believer, you're looking at this, you're looking at the risk and reward, or through the lens of risk and reward. And what's the risk? The risk in accepting Christ, the risk in believing in him, the risk in following him, the risk in letting the chains of sin fall from your wrists and your ankles. What is the risk of following Christ, of picking up his cross and following him? There are none. I've since 19, I know this is my birthday today, but this is my, did anybody miss that? But it was my first birthday. My most important birthday was the fall of 1970. And nobody told me about risk and reward. I was all in. Sins paid for, eternal life is a hope. You know, come on, it was a good deal. But let's just say you're skeptical and you're going risk and reward here. The risk is nothing. And anything you're going to have to give up are things that were not good for you in the first place. Amen? And everything else is going to come. It's going to be good. So the reward is everything, everything, everything. And, you know, we're all worried. Somebody told me earlier their 401k in the last 2 weeks became a 104. Either they're dyslexic or they're broke. I don't know. But we worry about tomorrow so much. But I tell you what, God's got this. Wouldn't that make a good t-shirt? And his retirement plan's out of this world. Literally. It's out of this world. And the streets are paved with gold out of this world. So yeah, it's we want to be mindful that our families are taken care of and everything. Guys, we got to. But don't put all your eggs in that basket. We need to be investing where the streets are made with gold. Amen. In his love, it's just amazing. So we are loved. And so then, remember, that's the vertical. The vertical earlier is he loves us, right? This is vertical for those of you who didn't go to school. I'd like to make sure, you know, there's people watching at home, other countries. Vertical, he loves us. Jesus talks about he abided in the Father's love, right? Now, there comes a horizontal. We know we're loved by God. We are reflecting that back up in our worship, our prayer, and our service. But now, we have to go horizontal, and we have to love others. This becomes a huge rub. I don't know about you guys, because not everybody's really lovable. Oh, don't you? You know what I'm saying? Some people are really lovable. I mean, some people are like, gosh, they can't do anything wrong. I mean, anything they say is like, okay. Yeah, except for Calvin. But some people, you don't even want to give them a chance. They're just, you write them off. They're obnoxious. They're needy. They're clingy. They're whatever. We are commanded to love others. And I'm going to get to that in just a second. So our love for him, does it really mean that much if we're not doing the horizontal piece, which, by the way, becomes like the shape of a cross, which we're supposed to pick up every day anew and carry it, knowing that we're reflecting God's love he has for us. It's unconditional, remember. He can't love us any more or any less. We want to reflect that, but then we have to go horizontal and love others. Love others. Tell somebody next to him you love them. Oh, yeah. Honey, you can look up here. Okay. Adrian. Rocky. That's the Balboa factor. I'll get into that next week. So we got the vertical, we got the horizontal. Let's talk about loving others. And you know what's so important about this is before you say anything, you know, I this is about the time I might say, what's love got to do with it?
Everything.
Okay. What's love got to do with it?
Everything.
This is one of our new t-shirts. And it has open range on the back. This will get somebody to ask you what you're all about. Be ready for anything with that one. Let me get dressed here. On TV. But we don't care. Remember when I changed my belt on TV when Ernie was here? Yeah. I had some emails on that one. But they were all good. So let's talk about, real quick, our love for others. As a matter of fact, turn to John chapter 15 if you got your Bibles. If not, it'll all be up here. John chapter 15. Are your paper rustling? Are you there? Okay. I go on them, so you better hustle. John 15. Let's start with verse 9 and 10. As the Father has loved me, this is Jesus talking, is the Father has loved me. I mean, use the action steps to get this. Is the Father has loved me, I have loved you. Oh, there's that vertical and there's the horizontal. Abide in my love. Abide in my love. Yeah, live there. Live there. Remain there. Make it your home, your casa, all those things. If you keep my commandments, you abide in my love. Boy, there's a big action step. Just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. So Jesus kept the Father's commandments, and we are to keep Jesus' commandments. So you're going, well, you know, isn't that like works? Oh, come on, give me a break. This is Jesus Christ. He went to the cross for you. When he has a commandment, it is good for you. It will benefit you. It will benefit the body of Christ, the bride. It'll benefit the non-believers because you'll draw them to you because all of a sudden you've got this insatiable hunger to reach the lost. You've got a compassion that wells up. You know, when you do these things and you follow what Jesus says and you abide, when you abide in his love and when you abide in his commandments, things happen. When you draw unto him, he will draw near to you. Things happen when you do that, when you step, when you take that step. Remember the whole free will thing. When you were a kid, did you ever just like, you're just like this? And your mom's saying, come here, and you're just like, eh. That's us. Has anybody ever seen that picture of the baby? Jesus is a little boy standing on the water, and his mom's saying, Mary's saying, in. Now. And he's just standing on the water. I know, that's silly. But that's us. But when we unfold our arms and we take a step towards him, he draws to us. Matter of fact, he runs to you. That's the whole story of the prodigal son. He comes down the driveway at a dead run to meet you when you come to him and say, hey, I want to love you, and I want to love the church, and I want to abide in you, and I want to keep your commandments, and I want to have faith, and I want to have purpose. It's all there, and I want to love people, especially people you don't like. Ask the Lord. Give me a heart for them. You might really be surprised what he does. Really. So let's read on in 13 and 14, or 11 and 12, sorry. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy might be in you. Now, pause there for a second. Remember, I told you, he doesn't have anything bad for you, okay? He's asking you to keep the commandments so that you're abiding in him for this very reason. He's spoken this that we might have joy. Joy may be in you. Not just in you, that your joy may be full. I mean full. Full. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Now, I told you last summer when I got out of the hospital after I could finally talk because of the trach tubes, I got a hold of a couple of people that I didn't know if we were, you know, on good terms. There had been kind of a necessary ending, but it was kind of left rough. And what a blessing it was, because I took the first step. He wants us to take the first step. And then he brought a blessing to me that I can't even tell you. Plus, there's two more people I can see in Tractor Supply without diving behind the welding equipment. Have you ever had that happen? It's like, they're so-and-so quick. That's where I see Jerry all the time. We're behind the welding equipment at Tractor Supply. Yeah, we're hiding. So-and-so's here, stay down. You can't live like that. But more than that, I know there's people, even in this room, this is a serious subject, I'm not going to point to anybody or anything, but I know there's people that have something they haven't fixed yet. And it could be some relationship that's broken, it could be something within the family. But he's saying, you, to have the joy and to abide in him, you have to keep the commandments. And the commandment is to love one another. And forgiveness is rooted within that, because that keeps us from loving one another most of the time. You know, have you ever had somebody, walk in and you're like, oh, they're so-and-so. Oh, gosh. Can't believe they're here. Does that sound like the heart of God? So we have to get past that to where we can at least go, they're here. No, we have to get even farther past. Baby steps. Baby steps. But you might be surprised. I was telling Brenda the other night, there was a guy back in school that hit it. He'd said something, spread a rumor about me and a girl, and nothing had ever happened. I mean, I didn't even date her, but he spread this rumor. And when I found out about it, I went into the classroom, I confronted him, and we went to the ground, and we knocked desk over, and everybody's going, this is violent. Frank, why are you telling this story? This is why, because justice had to happen, first off. It had to be clarified what was going on to protect the girl. I wasn't too worried about myself. But you know what happened from that? We became best friends. We became best friends. If I would have let that go, if I hadn't confronted him, and I don't say go beat up the person that you have a problem with. I know I'm going to get emails from this. I'm saying don't let it go. Don't blow it off. Don't say, well, I'll just ignore it and see what happens. No, confront it. And if it is something serious, be ready to do whatever it takes, but confront it. And ask God, which I didn't in this situation, to let the peace come, to prepare the way, that the truth can come out and that healing can happen. So forgiveness, I'm telling you, as we finish these first 5 weeks of July and we start the book of Ruth next week, we don't want anything to hinder us. As we've been going through this marriage study on Sunday nights, we don't want anything to hinder us, our love for God or for each other. We need to fix things. And if you got to fix something this week, tonight, tomorrow, just do it. Pray about it a little bit. Don't, you know, people say, well, gosh, you know, I'll pray about it. And it's like 10 years later, still praying. I haven't heard a thing. He ain't talking. Well, it's because of your attitude. You go to him and say, Lord, how can this get fixed? He'll talk to you. He'll put you in the path of that person is what he'll do. So just fix things, because this whole get up, ride up, and mount on series has been so that we can be effective followers, spiritually fit followers of Christ. Amen? That we can be Pony Express riders with one goal, that's to deliver the gospel of Jesus Christ to the world and build kingdom. Amen? With one goal, to fulfill the Great Commission, Matthew 28. Amen? With one goal, to be Holy Spirit-filled witnesses for Christ, Acts 1:8. And these are things that there's things that get in our way. There's things in our own lives, like unforgiveness, that can dismount us in the woods area of this trip. Eliminate them. Eliminate them. You've got the power because you've got the power of the Holy Spirit inside of you. I'm talking to believers. Do it. That's all I'm saying. And then 13 and 14. Jesus talking. Greater love has no one than this. Boy, you talk about a pregnant pause. When Jesus pauses, you'd think E.F. Hutton was nothing, let me tell you. Greater love has no one than this. Oh, listen up. That someone lay down one's life for his friends. If you are my friends, if you do what I command you. Oh, boy, if he hadn't said that, we'd have been okay. But let me tell you, this talks about sacrifice, and it talks about trust, and it talks about obedience right here. So if you want to sacrifice, if you're willing to sacrifice yourself for a member of the body of Christ or anyone, if you're one of those guys, men, I know how it is. Have you ever been in a situation where you dive in and take a bullet? You know, if you've ever been, and I know our chaplain's seen it all, Steve Quiggs, when he was in Iraq, and a lot of you guys, but also the women here, let me tell you guys are ready to sacrifice. Even if it's on a smaller scale for your kids or your grandkids, you talk about seeing a woman get mad. You know what I'm saying? Mess with the chicks. She will get you. So if you're willing to sacrifice yourself for the body of Christ, for the bride of Christ. You know, if you're willing to go to bat for that person that I said earlier you didn't really like, and somebody says something about them and go, no, you can't say anything bad about them. Only I can. No, I'm just saying. You know what I'm saying? Defend them. And then you'll see that's also a path towards reconciliation, which, listen up, is the first ministry that Jesus Christ gives us when we get saved. The ministry of reconciliation. And we need to use it. So you've got the sacrifice in that verse. Lay down one's life for your friends. But we've got the obedience. Are we going to be obedient to live out what he commands us to do? And what's he commanding us to do in the context of this week? Love one another. Love one another. I don't want to rip my shirt open again, so I'll lose a button. But what's love got to do with it? Okay. It really does. And the very last point here is, and you guys listen to this. I'm so excited about this. You know, that old saying, even a blind hog finds an acorn once in a while. This is an acorn. And the church doesn't have to be blind anymore. This is so incredible. Because what I'm going to share with you right now, are you guys even ready for this? I mean, really. Who wants me to share this truth that I found out? Get excited about it. God's love is unshakable. It's unshakable. We already learned that he can't love you anymore and he can't love you any less. But let me tell you, it is unshakable love. Romans 8:39 says, "For I am convinced," and we kind of sang this in a song earlier, "that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither present nor future, nor any power, neither height nor depth, nor anything in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord." That's good news. I don't know about you guys, but I've done some things that I should have been separated out, just like a coal cow at an auction. There's one that limps. Get him out of here. There's one that's old. He's just turned 50. 51. You know, there's something with a blemish right over there called Frank. Call him out. Call him out. Call him out. Jesus Christ is not going to call you out. His love is unshakable. If you have gotten into the pit or on the ground, he's going to work with you till you're back up and you're in that saddle and you're riding hard with the gospel of Jesus Christ with faith, with hope, with love. Amen? I'm going to end this with a story. This story is an actual true story, and it took place up in Iowa, out in the country, which is pretty much any four directions from Des Moines. So I didn't have to say east or west or south or north. This was in the country, and it's about a man who was a county agent of a rural area. And he gets a phone call about 4:30, quarter to 5 in the morning. Don't you hate it when the phone goes off then? It said the old Morton place was burning. Now, the Morton place was one of these old farms that had been passed through several generations. Classic two-story farmhouse, and all the barns were like from the 1920s. You know, the ones that you see falling down now, they're almost gone. And so his heart was just sunk that this place is burning, right? Especially this time of night. It's never good. Never good. So he gets dressed, and he's driving out there. It's a pretty good drive. And he gets a phone call from the guy who had told him. I think it was the insurance guy or another county agent. Somebody called him and said there were no survivors. Everybody was lost. And his stomach just, you've all gotten a phone call where you just sink. This was a good family. It was a mom and dad, and they weren't that old. They were younger than me. And they had a grandma there, surviving grandma, had five kids. Stretching from like 8 to, you know, young, early college age. All gone. When he gets to where he can see the driveway up ahead as he's going down this gravel road, he sees that the last fire truck's pulling out and leaving volunteer firemen. And when he turns up that driveway as he gets to the house, the last emergency vehicle's pulling out. And he finds himself alone as the sun's coming up. And he walks up to the house first, and he looks at their life out in the yard, books and clothes and dolls and teddy bears, all covered with soot and all drenched in water. And he thinks, God, how could you let this happen? I mean, really? And he thinks he'll walk out around the barn area, and the barns are gone. Some of the tractors are just charred, but it's bad. And as he walks around the barn, he sees something on the ground. And it's a bird. And it's got its wings out like this. And he's going, I didn't even know what it is. Never seen a bird look like this. Wings were black, and it was just hard. Hard and black. And he got closer, and he said, that's a chicken. You never see one with their wings out like that. And he doesn't know why he did it, but he took his boot and he flipped this stiff chicken over, this charred chicken. And underneath were all the baby chicks alive. Alive. And he dropped to his knees and he started gathering up those chicks and he started crying uncontrollably because they were alive. Family was lost. These chicks are alive. When I heard that story, I thought, you know, we live in a war zone. And Jesus Christ has his wings stretched out over those who've accepted him as their Lord and Savior. Those that are in his care. Those that are called his bride. And he stretched his wings out over us. That's love. And you know how much Jesus loves us? This much. As his arms were stretched out on the cross. Let's just close our eyes. You know, we've clearly seen, and most of us know how much God loves us, but it slips from our conscience because we're beaten up in this world. We beat ourselves up. But he can't love us anymore, and he can't love us any less. It's unconditional. It's not depending on how much we do or how little we do. It's the fact that we're identified with him by accepting what he did on the cross. When we exchanged our filthy rags for his robes of righteousness, we became his. And now we're loved with an everlasting love. And beneath are the everlasting arms. And stretched out over us are those wings of protection, just like that old hen that sacrificed herself. If you can think of something that would help you to really abide in his love, I mean, something, an action step. Maybe it's following his commandments. Maybe it's asking someone for forgiveness or forgive someone yourself. Whatever it is that will put you in a sweet spot of not only having faith and hope, but also abiding in the love of Jesus Christ, I want you just to identify it. And while you're doing that, if you haven't ever had Jesus Christ stretch his wings out over you in a symbol of salvation. If you're here tonight and you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, or you're not sure you've ever fully trusted, there's great news tonight that he came and he died for you. We read the verse. But guess what? They buried him and then he rose from the dead to prove that you're going to rise from the dead too. He's the first fruit, and we're the fruit that will follow. Is there anybody that is interested in this great, great news tonight? Is there anybody that's willing to give their lives as a living sacrifice to him tonight, fully trusting, fully obeying, with full of hope, full of faith, abiding in him, in him abiding in you, seeing your sins put in the deep part of the sea, seeing your transgressions separated from you like the east is from the west, and never remembered again, no matter what you've done. If that's you, I just want you to look up and make eye contact with me. Just look me right in the eye. Nobody else is looking around. Jesus, tonight, the one and only. Anybody want Jesus tonight, the one and only? God bless you. Jesus, the one and only. Anyone else? This is the kind of deal you don't want to get past you here. Anyone else? Jesus. Okay, Lord, I do want to pray over the ones who did make decisions, Lord. Fill them with your joy. Fill them with your Holy Spirit. Fill them with purpose, and fill them with your peace, and fill them with faith, and fill them with a hope that's unshakable. Lord, let them be surrounded with a peace that passes all understanding. In Jesus' name, Lord, amen. And the rest of you, keep your eyes down. Who here identified something that's keeping you from abiding in His love, and you're going to let it go right now? Raise your hand. God bless you and you and you and you. You, there's freedom. Anybody else? Freedom back there. I see freedom. Anybody else? Free, I see you. Freedom tonight. Don't hold back. Let it rip. Freedom. It's offered to you tonight. Anyone else? God bless you. Lord, thank you for this night, that your truth, like always, shines like the sun in our lives, like the S-O-N, Son of God, Son of Jesus, Jesus Christ, His love, His compassion, His sacrifice. Lord, help us, though. In our weakness, you say you are strong, and we're weak. We've got loved ones in the room that have died. We've got broken hearts. We've got broken marriages. We've got all this stuff, Lord, is happening every day. Not to mention we're all getting older and things are happening. It's all happening day after day after day. Lord, as we close this series, just don't let us lose hope. Don't let us get on the ground. Don't let us get in the pit. We want to ride with hope, and we want to ride with faith. We want to ride with love, and we want to finish the course. We want to finish this race strong. So, Lord, give us your strength. Give us your hope. Give us your faith. Give us your heart, the heart of God. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Woo! Let me tell you, isn't the Lord good? We're going to do a song. We don't do it very often, but it's very fitting. We Will Ride. And I want you guys to sing it like you've never sang it before. And if you've never sang it before, sing it like you're going to sing it tonight. Isn't that right, Calvin?
Right on.
Right on. By the way, the God of Wonders study is going to be in the back room. So Thursday night, just so you know. Because there's basketball in here, so those of you coming, come in the back.
It's a four-school wrestling tournament.